Happy to be joined by Donald Bogle, who has written extensively about the black experience on screen, movies and television. And Donald is here to talk about Sergeant Rutledge, which is part of our lineup on the final Friday in July, where we highlight the films of John Ford. Donald, as always, pleasure to talk to you.
Pleasure to talk to you, Ben.
Sergeant Rutledge, this is an important movie because it is the first studio Western with a black man leading the cast, although you wouldn't know that from looking at the poster.
No, you wouldn't know it from looking at the poster. I mean, in a sense, I don't know if they wanted people to know it really starred Woody Strode. You know, that's one of the issues with this. When John Ford first said he wanted Woody Strode, the studio did not want him. And it's very funny that the studio said, you know, that they could see Sidney Poitier or they could see Harry Belafonte as Sergeant Rutledge. And John Ford is reported to have said, according to Woody Strode, they're not tough enough. And I think you can understand what Ford was saying once you actually see the movie, because Woody Strode doesn't have to open his mouth. I mean, just visually, he is a tower of strength and also a tower of endurance. He is one of the most charismatic actors to work in American motion pictures. And of course, he simply does not have to say a word. So audiences may have gone in not quite realizing who they were going to see in this film, but no one left without knowing Woody Strode, even though this movie was not a great success. But it has endured, and Woody Strode himself has endured.
First Sergeant Braxton Rutledge, C Troop, 9th United States Cavalry.
There is a masculinity to Woody Strode that I think strikes you from the moment you see him on screen.
Precisely, and I don't mean to sound as if I'm critical of Poitier or Belafonte. It's just a different kind of screen presence and something that worked, you know, Strode just worked exceptionally well in this movie. And it was an important film for him, and it was an important film for John Ford, because it's John Ford dealing with an African-American character and a situation in a way that he hadn't previously done. You know, there was a lot of discussion about Ford, the way that he depicted African-Americans, notably someone like Stephen Fetchett, who had been in Judge Priest in 1934 for Ford, and he also had done other movies. And Fetchett was a talented performer, but when you see him in those movies, he does represent for many people this this slow-moving, slow-thinking, dim-witted character. And we would hardly think of him as being heroic or a symbol of some kind of racial situation. When Ford does this film that was released in 1960, he's looking again at the way he's depicted black characters. And he's giving us something else with Woody Strode. We get a racial situation here, and we also see in this movie, which Ford is aware of, even though we may feel he doesn't articulate it enough, but he's aware of it, and that is the ties between sex and racism in America and American history. And so Woody Strode comes on. He's, as you know, a character accused of having raped and murdered a young white woman. And how is the culture going to deal with this? And how is Woody Strode going to prove his innocence? And what actually happened? And Ford uses that to spin off and to make a comment about African-Americans and African-Americans in the military. So it's a different kind of depiction for John Ford.
The most striking moment, I think, in the movie, and where it's really most effective in dealing with race in a realistic, upfront way, is the moment where Strode suddenly emerges out of the darkness and puts his enormous hand over Constance Towers' mouth to keep her quiet so she is not heard by the Apaches. And I imagine audiences in 1960 reacted to that, a black man's hand suddenly over the face of a white woman, But Ford seems to, knowing that reaction, he is using that reaction to sort of, I guess, make the audience question their own stereotypical beliefs.
Yes, precisely. You know, I mean, that scene that you've mentioned, when we see the brown hand come over her mouth, I think we all just stop. I mean, just visually, it is stunning. And audiences at that time were used to seeing black characters depicted in a certain way, and certainly not seeing, it really is an intimate moment. And I think Ford handles that exceptionally well, because he's playing in a way with audience perceptions dealing with race and black males, white women, and he's dealing with misconceptions. And he spins off from there. But that is just a striking moment in this movie that I think, obviously, it sets things in motion. So we find out what is going on and what actually happened with Sergeant Rutledge. You know, Ben, there's another sequence in the film where Woody Strode is with Constance Towers, and he's been wounded, and he has to take off his shirt. And initially, she was to take to help him get out of his shirt and to look at his wound. And they didn't do it that way. And they had him remove the shirt. But that, too, is just startling to see. I mean, Woody Strode's in great shape. And there he is with this fragile, blonde, white woman. And you audiences might have had thoughts back to D.W. Griffith's The Birth of a Nation, if audiences had memories that long in 1960. They probably didn't. But the knowledge of this black man, and he's half-dressed in that sequence, and with this white woman, and Woody Strode is completely in control of himself. He's not panting after her. She's not secretly panting after him. So it's just one of these moments where we stop. And I do think that, too, is a racially intimate moment. You know, when we think also about Poitier and Belafonte during this era and how they were depicted and sexuality was depicted with them, here it's really different, because it's we have to pull back and we're thinking, and there is no violation of this woman, and Woody Strode doesn't violate himself. I mean, he's not lusting after her. He's just there, and he's this great figure to watch. But I do think that's intimate, and I think that Ford just handled that so well, as did Woody Strode and Constance Towers.
This is an important movie, and I'm thinking that you're going to see this as progress. But there are so many flashes back to how Hollywood had dealt with race before, and would continue, of course, to do so for many years. And one thing that struck me in the film, aside from the sort of nonsensical framing of a love story between Constance Towers and Jeffrey Hunter, which really shouldn't be the focus of a movie called, you know, Sergeant Rutledge. but is that the racism that you know would have pervaded throughout the officer corps and the cavalry and with the judges at this court-martial, but the racism is really almost solely focused on the prosecuting attorney. It's like they turn him into the one bad guy while everyone else is pretty much just okay with things. And I don't know, that didn't sit right
well,
with me.
Yes, I think,
and I'm curious your thoughts.
Well, no, I mean, even Constance Towers, the way her character is depicted, I mean, she's a very perceptive, sensitive figure. And the young white girl who ends up being raped and murdered, not by Woody Strode's character, of course, but their dealings with him, it is idealized. And it really, Ford is removing a certain kind of hate that was within the culture itself, and of course tied into that is racism. So he doesn't really go there. And even Jeffrey Hunter's character he admires Sergeant Rutledge, Woody Strode's character. So Ford is really not going as far as we would want him to go. And in depicting the racism or racial attitudes of the military at that time and the culture at large. You know, I'll say this about Ford. I mentioned Stephen Fetchett, who had worked with John Ford in the past. And John Ford made a movie in 1953 called The Sun Shines Bright. And you can see there something's changing with him. And it's a reworking of a movie he had done with Fetchett in 34, Judge Priest, that starred Will Rogers. In the 1953 film, Fetchett is in it again, and not much different than he was in the 1934 film. But the movie in 53, it deals in part with a young white woman who's been attacked, and blamed for this is a young black. He's actually a teenager. And there is a mob that wants to lynch him, and it's proven that he didn't do it and he's innocent. But Ford is trying to get at something there, but he hasn't gone, he must have felt he didn't go far enough. And he comes back to this in Sergeant Rutledge and tries to explore it more, but he still cannot, he's not willing to really fully examine the culture at large, and in that respect, the military culture. The other thing I will say that Ford does do in this, which is interesting, is that, you know, Sergeant Rutledge is a Buffalo soldier, and this is historically, yeah. The Buffalo soldiers, they were troops of black soldiers that came about after the Civil War, 1866, and they were involved in the Indian Wars, and Native Americans referred to them as Buffalo soldiers because they were wearing, one story is they were wearing buffalo skins and so forth to stay warm, and Native Americans were sort of puzzled by them. But one thing Ford is trying to show us is that these Buffalo soldiers are a part of America and a part of American history and important for the expansion into the West. So he sees them as heroic, and we shouldn't forget them. But the irony of it in this film, when we look at it today, is that the Buffalo soldiers, their involvement in the Indian Wars, and as we see it here with Native Americans, they are, we're seeing one minority brought into the system, but at the same time, they are opposed to another minority.
Yeah,
we couldn't fully
get it right at the same time.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, there is one sequence where there's the dying Buffalo soldier who comments on this white man's war, and yeah. They have been brought into this. And as I said, it's historically true that there were the Buffalo soldiers, and they were heroic. But there's another question that this movie does not ask. And for us today, you know, with another kind of awareness, and I would say even among some audiences in 1960, where they were happy to see this heroic black soldier and the others as well, because they are not buffoons, the Buffalo soldiers in this film, those black soldiers. But the movie is still hedging on certain things, and yeah. In that respect, Ford does not move forward. But I'll say something else about this movie and about Woody Strode in some of his other films. You know, the American West itself, and with the whole thing of the cowboys, and they're military men, but we might see them as cowboys too. And so, it's been estimated that about 20-30% of the actual cowboys in the Old West were black, Mexican, or Native Americans. And in this kind of portrait of the Old West that Hollywood would give us, for the most part, you didn't see them. You just didn't think of African Americans as cowboys and a part of the history of the Old West, and that's something that was denied to us. At the same time, which is rather interesting and showing the need of black audiences for the idea of blacks in the Old West, there were race movies starring Herb Jeffries, the singing cowboy, Bronze Buckaroo, and Two Gun Man from Harlem, which did give us the black westerns for the black movie audiences, because black kids loved the westerns as much as anyone else, but there was a denial there of giving them, you know, members of their own race as heroic figures in that history. Yeah. And they certainly were there in actuality. So Ford does, in a sense, I mean, he's bringing that into this portrait of the old West and the old military.
Yeah. Well, Donald, thank you as always. It's a pleasure to talk to you, get your perspective. And just a quick reminder from me before we go, the power of movies, because you just told the story about the percentage of black, Mexican, and Native American cowboys. And the first time, when I learned that, it surprised me, because yeah. my entire image of the Old West, which I know is not true, but was framed by movies. So when I read that, I was like, really? You know, like,
yeah.
And it's not something that really ought to surprise anybody, but it just goes to show the power of the art form. So as always, Donald, talking to you is a revelation, and we